with VS Code by Brijraj Singh. Brij is a senior tech evangelist at Microsoft. Brij has a decade worth of experience in both Microsoft technologies as well as open source technologies. He tweets interesting anecdotes on OS, IoT, and Microsoft at Brijraj Singh. Please, sir, we are glad to have you here.
Check, 1, 2, 3. Again? Okay. Thank you. Hello, everyone. Hello. Welcome to PyDelyConf 2017. My name is Brijraj Singh. You can call me Brij. Here's my Twitter handle in case you want to get in touch with me. I work as a senior technology evangelist with Microsoft, and my focus is on open source technologies while I work with startups and work on booting up the open source communities in India and providing them as much support as we can. Here's my Twitter handle in case you want to get in touch with me. So let's just quickly go over the agenda. Today I'm going to discuss Python tools from Microsoft. We'll be discussing Visual Studio Code and Visual Studio tools for Python. We'll see how to debug Python applications with Visual Studio Code and Visual Studio 2015. We'll discuss what and the why of containers, why you should use containers, and how containers work. We'll discuss the types of containers. We'll Dockerize an existing Python application. And I'll probably show you a little bit of Azure Container Services if we have enough time. And we'll run our Docker. May I continue? Okay. Thank you. And at the end, I'll take your questions. So what does Microsoft have to do with Python development? About 4 years back, actually 6 years back, Microsoft started working on something called Visual Studio Tools for Python. That's when a team sitting out of Seattle office thought, can we provide functionality within the Visual Studio so people can develop Python code over there. Now, if you remember, during that time, Microsoft didn't have any focus towards any open source technology whatsoever. Okay, for us, the world was all about C#, F#, Visual Basic, and that's pretty much, right? And .NET, whatever supports .NET. We had a foray into Python. We worked on something called Iron Python, if you remember, which is a .NET port of Python. But other than that, we didn't have anything to do with open source. So during that time, we started working on Visual Studio tools for Python, which allowed people to actually download a tool and integrate that tool with the Visual Studio itself. And then they can develop and debug applications within the Visual Studio if it's using Python. The problem with Visual Studio family was that it's a paid tool, right? While everybody in Python world, Node.js world, and all those open source technologies world prefer to use tools which are free of cost, of course. And that's when tools like Sublime and Atom started coming up, and everybody started using those tools. Many of you probably use Sublime or Atom, and many people use tools like PyCharm and all. And they obviously have their own enterprise versions. So about 2 years back, Microsoft started working on its own tool, and we thought, why not complete the story? First of all, let's make Visual Studio tools for Python a bit more better. Try to make sure that a version of Visual Studio comes for free, for the open source developers, of course, and for people who just want to play with the stuff. So we came up with Visual Studio Community Edition that you can download and you can use it for free. Okay, but it's a pretty big IDE itself. You can do a lot of stuff if you're using Visual Studio as in a full blown IDE. Okay, you can do whatever you can do with an enterprise IDE. So on one side we were working on Visual Studio Community Edition. On the other side we were working on VS Code. VS Code is a lightweight IDE for open source and for Microsoft technologies development. So if you want to develop Node.js applications, Python applications, Ruby applications, Go applications, you name it applications, anything, you can use Visual Studio Code. And Visual Studio Code is a free and open source IDE for that matter. Now, it's available on code.visualstudio.com. It runs on Linux. It runs on Mac OS X. It runs on Windows. And it's the same features that you get on all three of these platforms. Okay, and obviously it's available on GitHub. If you want to make any changes, if you want to bring in your own extensions, go ahead, fork the repo, do a pull request. And you can see on the repo itself, it has more than 300 plus contributors over there. And out of these contributors, many, many contributors are from the community itself. And we provide really fantastic support. If you want to develop your own plugins and of your own extensions, the documentation support is really good. And that's what Microsoft has always been good at. Now, Python tools for Visual Studio, a tool that enables your existing Visual Studio installation to work with Python, that is also available on GitHub. So if you want to bring in any changes, if you want to customize that, you're more than welcome to do that as well. Obviously, it supports CPython, IronPython, editing, browsing, IntelliSense, mixed Python, C++ debugging, remote Linux and Mac OS X debugging, we'll see that, profiling, IronPython, and of course, other frameworks like Django and Flask and Model. So let's just quickly run over for a demo of Visual Studio 2015, Python tools for VS, and Visual Studio Code, wherein we'll do some Python development and we'll do some debugging. Okay? So I'll quickly jump into the demo. And we don't have much time, so I'm just going to do it really quickly. Here I have a Visual Studio 2015. Okay? Let me just close the solution. And let me just open another one. This is just normal Visual Studio Professional 2015. If you have Community Edition, it will still do well. Okay? You just need to install Python tools for Visual Studio. And while it opens up, I'll show you an application which I've already developed. This is an application that comes out of box. If you want to develop a bottle-based application, this is a bottle framework-based application. You can see that it uses the virtual environment of Python. Okay? It allows you to switch between the virtual environment, and if you want to use your own installation of Python, you can do that too. So how many of you use virtual ENV? That's good. So it supports that. Okay? And the installation of tools is really easier. You can just right-click and say install Python package. And you know, you can select between the conda and the pip and the easy install, whatever you want to. One thing for sure is that it doesn't bring in anything extra to your Python code. So if you feel that Visual Studio is going to introduce some things to make it work, that's not so. Other than PTVS, that is the Python tools for Visual Studio, there's nothing more. Okay. And that same PTVS you will also use in Visual Studio Code if you want to do the debugging, okay? Because that is something which is going to make it easy for you to do the remote debugging. Other than that, normal debugging, you won't need PTVS, okay? So here is an application. This is our app.py. And if I want to debug, let me just open a file where I want to debug. And debugging, for debugging support, there is nothing better than Visual Studio. That's what I've seen over the period of like past 15 years or so. Okay, so I've set up some debugging points here. And what we are going to do is we are just going to press F5. Okay. And you see it has hit a breakpoint, just like that. Okay? I can get into the dict and I can see what is there inside. Right? And if there is something inside the dict, we will know. But for now, I'm going to do F5. I'm just going to continue. The web page is open here. Now we are going to do create sample polls. And you'll see it has hit the breakpoint again. Right? Now it's saying returning dict title polls, and I'm going to continue again. Now, how you commute to work or school, I'm providing some information. I'm saying vote, right? And it's just working the way it should be. You can see that it says choice key is 4, right? I can get more information, whatever I want to. I can dig into whatever I want to. I can also go ahead and move to details of the functions. You can see that there are lots and lots of functions and functionalities available to help you do debugging better. And if you can debug better, of course, you can develop faster, right? That's the overall point behind developing tools like Visual Studio. Okay, you can set up the watches and everything from here itself. So whatever a normal Visual Studio developer can do with their own C# solutions and other solutions, you can do that with your Python solution. Obviously, your development speed will be more and more faster. Now, I have the similar piece of code. First of all, let me just show you how to make one project. So we'll go to new project. And you will see that Python is one of the installed templates. Visual Studio itself is getting pretty unique now, because now you can do development of languages like R from here within the Visual Studio itself. Okay. So I have a template of R as well, but today we are going to just focus over Python. So I have some ready samples available here, Pulse Bottle web project, or a Pulse Django web project, or Flask web project. We do this because we want the developers to have some cookie cutter code that they can use themselves, or they can create their own solutions if they want to. So I'll just select a Pulse Bottle web project, and I'm just going to say Bottle web project, and bang. It'll obviously do the installation from the requirements.txt and everything on its own, okay? And we are going to soon bring in support of Docker within the Visual Studio for Python, okay? We already have it for C# and other applications, where you can just right-click and say Dockerize this app. That's it. You don't need to do anything else. And you want to deploy it, you just right-click and say Publish. That's it. You don't even need to learn Docker to Dockerize an application if you want to use Visual Studio. Okay, so here is the option. Not right now. Right. So there's a good scope of developing an extension that can help you do that. Okay. So here you have options of installing into a virtual environment, or installing into Python 64-bit 2.7, or if you want to install it yourself. Okay. You have your fair share of options available here. I can select one of these. I can name my environment here. I can select the version of Python that I want to work with. And obviously, I can say download and install packages right now if the requirement.txt is present here. Okay, so if I just let it be, it will just start doing that installation and everything. But we don't want to spend time here, obviously. So I'll come back to Visual Studio Code. Now, we'll go and see Visual Studio Code. So this is Visual Studio Code. I have some code over here, which is something I've taken from internet. It's a what for lunch demo. What this demo does is it has options for plugging in SQLite or MySQL or DocumentDB. You can pick up anything, or even MongoDB. And it throws you a page. That page allows you to define what you've had for lunch. That's it, just like that. So something really basic. Let's just go and take a look at our code. Here's our code. So when you will open Visual Studio, and you will have, this is your Visual Studio code over here. Right now, I don't want you to see the launch.json or anything like that. But this is my basic code here, okay? And normally, you can, I mean, if you are running an application, you usually run it like this, right? You say Python, and you you name the file itself, right? And it just runs this file. So I'm just going to do an enter, and it's going to run this. OK, so it's running on port 5000. And it's asking, what are you eating? So I'll say, hi, my name is Breach. And I ate a pizza. And I say, share my lunch. That's it. Now, if you want to debug this solution, you have multiple options available. First is you can debug it just like the way you were debugging it in Visual Studio. So let's just go and see that. Okay. So doing that is pretty simple. You go to the debug option. Okay. And I just need to reduce the font size a little. Yeah. And on the right, when you will right-click the debug over here, you will see an option of selecting Python or integrated terminal console or Django debugging or Flask debugging or Watson debugging. I didn't do anything over here. If you are developing a Python code, it will give you the debug options of Python. If you are developing a Node.js code, it will do the debug option of Node.js. And if there is any Node.js developer in the room, I can tell you that it's a painful process for setting up the Node.js debugging. But in Visual Studio Code itself, it's a no-brainer. You just start doing the debugging that you want to. Okay. So now, before we go for that debugging, we'll just kill this demo over here. Okay. And see that it has hit the debug point over here. And it's the same shortcuts here, F5, I can do that. Or I can just open it on localhost. And I'm just going to set up some points here. So you just open your code here, whatforlunch.py, and you can do the debugging here itself. So you can see that lunch submitter is hitting, and so on and so forth. And I can do F10, 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 right? Just like that. Now, it's also running this on localhost 5000 port. So I said, share my lunch, and then again, it has hit a breakpoint for me, okay? And I can again debug this breakpoint. So if I want to go and see something inside db.session, I can quickly just peek into this, okay? And within the db.session, I can see whatever I want to see, right? I can get into anything now. You can see? Neat? Okay. Now, sometimes what happens is you have the same piece of code running somewhere. Let's say that you've deployed this on a website. Okay, so it's running somewhere, and you want to do remote debugging of that code from here itself, from your local machine. Okay, so now you are unable to do that as well. For that, you need to use Python tools for Visual Studio, because that is something which is going to make sure that the symbols on the other side match the symbols on the production side. So it will sort of create a tunnel, and if the symbols match line to line, if you haven't made any single changes on your client side, it will work. Okay. So, but for that, you will need to make some changes in your code, which are not major changes. So you'll go to debugging, and on the Python side, you'll select attach remote debug. Okay. This option is available for all the languages. So if you have a language like Go or Node.js or Ruby for that matter, and if you want to set up a remote debugging, you can do that. Okay. And it's really common in .NET developers to do remote debugging on production, sitting from their own machine, okay? So that's a normal thing. But I'm going to click on Attach Remote Debugger, and I'm going to go back to my code, and I want to show you two things here. First is that it will actually create a file called launch.json, okay? This launch.json file contains the debugging scripts for you. So we just need to focus on the last one, because these first ones, you don't need to actually change anything in these ones. So I'll go to the last one, the attach remote debug one. Okay, so let me just. So here as well, I don't need to do anything. I just need to define the port and the secret if there is any secret. Okay, and I need to define to which host I want to attach it. Okay, now since it's not deployed on production somewhere, what we will do is for the remote debugging purposes, we will attach the debugger to this. So we'll run it on localhost and then we will attach the debugger from the code to this localhost. Okay, up till now it's the code that we were running and which was creating the localhost instance, but now we are running localhost separately and we will attach our code to it after it has started running. Okay, so here obviously I have to see that everything is killed. It's killed over here. Okay, so we are going to plug to port 5000. Okay, nice. And before we go there, we need to write a couple of lines of code. This is also cookie cutter sort of code, and I hope that Microsoft will provide it someday default. But for now, you have to type this. I'll tell you what these lines are doing. So first, import ptbsd is actually importing the package Python tools for Visual Studio debugging. And then it says enable attach the secret and the address of the machine and the port. Okay. For now, this is 0000, but if it was running on a production, you'll provide the IP of that machine, okay? And this port 5000 will become obviously port 80 if it was a web app. And then you say wait for attach and break into debugger. These two lines are killer lines. This code would not start unless you bring in Python tools for Visual Studio debugger to work with this, okay? So this website would not start unless the debugger starts, okay? So if somebody wants to go back into the code, so I'm just going to say control KU. I've enabled these lines, okay? And what we'll do is we'll say python what for lunch.py. Right, so I've saved it. I'm going to do python what for lunch.py. Now you see that it doesn't say that the server had started. It's stuck over there, right? Now we'll go to the debugging and we'll say attach remote debug. I will say continue. Oops. Classic issue. Happens. Still fast. Right? So now we have brought in the debugger. That debugger is not executing the code. The debugger is just making sure that the code only starts after the debugger has plugged in with the code. Okay, so now we can move F10. Now actually I'm debugging something which was started on from the other terminal on localhost, right? So now it's running on localhost 5000. Nobody has actually browse the website, so we'll browse the website now. Right, so now we will add something to this. Say Sumit and I ate something. And then again, it has hit the breakpoint. Right, so this is remote debugging for you. And the feature is available, as I said, for all the languages that you have. And if it's not available for a certain language that you use and Microsoft doesn't know about it, do go ahead to the GitHub repository and add an issue over there. We'll be more than happy to make one. In fact, I'll be more than happy to make one. So let me just close this one. And now we will move on to Dockerizing an application. So how many of you know about Docker? Yes. Remote debugging? Well, of course, if the remote is on internet, then yes. If the application is running somewhere else, if the application is running in local, then you don't need it. It'll run without the internet. Okay, yes. So
can you give the repository where we can open issue?
Yes. This is the one. So code.visualstudio.com. The repository is at github.com/microsoft/vscode. Okay? And for PTVS as well, you can go and open one over there. So this morning, I'm also going to open one more issue over here. This morning, I was using PTVS, and I wanted to show you how to debug a container that is running inside Docker. Okay, so it's working, but it's not actually it's plugging to the code, but it's not actually moving forward in the code, right? So it stucks, but it doesn't move forward. If I say F5, it starts working. The Dockerize container starts working, but the debugger doesn't hit all the breakpoints that it should. Okay, so that's an issue, and of course we are working on that. Okay, coming back, how many of you know about Docker? One hand, two hand, three, four hand. Okay, obviously you know. So, and how many of you have used Docker in any production application? Just one hand. Okay. The reason why people are not using Docker in any production application is obviously the enterprises do not have belief. Okay. They do not believe the security of Docker as of now, and Docker itself is not claiming that it has the best security out there for the containers, and things would not seep through between the containers. But for everything else, I'm finding Docker is a fantastic, fantastic change that could have happened to the application world. The applications itself are changing. In early 2000s, you remember, we had these monolithic, slow-changing big servers. You made one application, and that application had a lot of layers in it. Okay? And if you want to bring in any change to any layer, although it was layered, but if you bring in any change anywhere, you will have to go through a build everywhere in the code, right? So one basic example is, let's say a new column was introduced in the system, right? So the developer will say, I have to add one column in the front end. Then I have to add something in the back end. Then I have to make some changes in the logic layer, okay? We have to make changes everywhere. And the build was... And the build process was too long. I don't know, is it timed? No. The build process was too long, and somewhere down the line, we started using service-oriented architecture, wherein we started decoupling the system. So whatever could become a service, we created a service out of it. And these services were self-standing services. You bring in any change to the service, it just remains to the service, right? But if there are some clients using the service, you can obviously let the clients know that we have brought in some changes. And where are those changes? And I don't want to discuss the SOA tenets right now, but it was pretty easy when you were using something like web services, and in Java world you had something called Corba, right? Wherein the server would expose that this is what I offer, and if I'm making some changes, then these are the changes, okay? These are the schemas that I offer. These are the endpoints that I offer. Obviously, that broke down when REST came in picture, okay? REST was too easy to work with, but then the ability to tell everybody that this is what we offer was not there, okay? And that's where the API revolution started, and some companies started doing API 2.0, wherein they created some standards around the REST APIs. And I can talk about the REST API standards later if you want me to. But then, right after these loosely coupled services came, each one of the services was doing a very specific task, right? So you have a service for login, right? You had a service for pulling in some data from database, like that. And in fact, the database itself became a service. So everything became a service, and these loosely coupled services, we started calling them microservices, right? And that's where we are today. We have many, many small servers. And the reason why you have these services separately is that you can scale them separately, right? Why would you like to do that? Let's say that you are running a batch application which sends email at the end of day. Right? And it's running in a very humble machine. Okay? Now, in the evening, when you start sending all those emails, you are hitting that machine like crazy for a couple of hours. Right? What if you can scale that application to 2, 3, or 4 machines at the end of day? Okay? That means you have flexibility of scaling just that part when you want it to. Okay? So any part of application can scale on its own. Okay, and as long as you can do that, it's a microservice-based architecture. Okay, how you scale is a different question altogether. Okay, and that's where things like Docker will come in picture. So this picture also showcases you how distributed applications could be, that you have static websites, background workers, user DB, web frontends, queues, DBs, and everything. And these things could be running on any one of these platforms, right? It can run on production cluster, it can run on a public cloud, it can run on your machine, obviously, you're the developer. It can run on a QA server and anywhere else, right? So everything is supposed to run everywhere, right? From the developer machine to the production machine, it's supposed to run everywhere. And how do you make sure that happens? Which is actually synonymous to something like this, but let's talk about this. In 1960s, you had cargo transport, right? Wherein if you are carrying any one of these above items, let's say you are carrying a sack of coffee, then obviously you need a specific type of transport mechanism for that, right? You need a specific packaging as well. Of course, you remember those days when I'm sure you watched those movies wherein people knew that in this car, this thing is going, right? You can guess. If it's a sack, you obviously know it may be carrying coffee or wheat grains or sugar or whatever, right? It cannot be carrying, obviously, tar or something like that. So to simplify the carrying process from one place to another and to make sure that you know how much space do you need for carrying a certain number of items, shipping industry came up with a concept of containers, right? So now, if you are somebody who carries sacks of coffee from one place to another, you know that X thousand number of coffee sacks can be placed in a container, right? So now when somebody says you want to carry X thousand number of sacks, you can say it will take us two containers, okay? First problem solved is you know how much space it is going to take. Okay? B, the space is optimized now. Since it's containers, the space is optimized now. So everything comes in the container, the space is optimized, you know how much space a container takes, right? As long as it's in the form of containers. Third problem is security. Nobody knows what's inside the container. So if you are carrying a container from one place to another, nobody can guess what's inside. It can have a Lamborghini, it can have a sack of coffee, it can have trash, it could be anything. Third thing is you can take these containers from here to anywhere else, and you can take it to somewhere else, you can open the container, you can make some changes in the container, you can pack it again, and you can send it to somewhere else, right? So what are containers, basically? Obviously, these are the containers. We had containers before, actually. Okay, in application world, we had containers before. But they weren't just too easy to use. The existing container technologies were C groups, LXC tools, Linux container tools, and namespaces from IBM. These were the technologies through which you can actually create your own containers. What does a container mean anyways? A container is basically a sort of a machine in which you can put your code and the dependencies and everything, okay? Obviously, it's not a full machine, but it's a representation which is like a machine itself, okay? And we'll see why. Let's say this is a classic scenario on the left-hand side. Generally, what happens is that you have a server, you have a host operating system on top of that, and you have a virtualization technology, which in this case could be hypervisor, right? Does somebody know about any other virtualization technologies? No? Come on. Theek hai, wo waise bhi rival technology, I won't talk about that. So yeah, on top of that, you had VMs, okay? You have guest operating system. Obviously, it could be anything. So if any one of you run virtual machines in your machine, you obviously know that you can put any kind of guest operating system in it, right? And you have binaries and libraries of that application and of guest operating system in your applications. Obviously, if the guest operating system is same as that of the host operating system, it doesn't matter anything to hypervisor. For hypervisor, it's a full-blown virtual machine. And obviously, if it contains the entire operating system inside, it's too big. So if you want to take one virtual machine from one place to another, it's difficult, right? Yes, of course, the scaling was easier. So if you have to boot two instances of the similar application, you boot two instances of this virtual machine, right? If you want to boot three instances, you boot three instances of the virtual machine. You can log into the virtual machine and do whatever you want to do, okay? But containers, they started revolutionizing the entire space. They said that now you can have a server, you can have a host operating system, and the applications itself, they can use the host operating system kernel. Because why do you actually need a full operating system here if you can use the kernel of the host operating system? So if I can use the kernel of the host operating system for all the basic things that I need, and for any specific things or dependencies, I can keep it inside the container itself. So this part is containers. And for whatever else, it uses the host operating system. Okay. So when you want to say that, hey, the host operating system is Linux, okay, and I'm writing a container which uses some services of Linux, then it obviously it will use the services of the host operating system. So it's very much optimized. And now you can take a container that you've developed here. Obviously, that container contains the application, contains the dependencies here itself, packed in itself. So you can take it from here and run it somewhere else. There is not an iota of difference, not even the difference of the kernel pieces, because the kernel is pretty much same everywhere, right? If you have a Linux kernel running on your machine and if you have a Linux kernel, Ubuntu kernel running on a production machine, there is practically no difference. And generally what happens is that developer says it works on my machine, it doesn't work on production, right? Because production can have different setup. But now they can't say that because you have actually packed everything that you have in your machine and you've taken it to other place, okay? So containers, they have layers. Right? And what layers do you have? Okay. I'm feeling you. Okay, so you have layers in the containers. You have obviously the kernel, the base kernel, okay? And on top of that, you have the base image of the operating systems that you are working with, okay? So the first version of the containers was actually provided by Google, but after that, a company called Docker came in picture, and Docker is not the only container technology out there, I can tell you that. But Docker is the most popular one because it sort of makes it easy for everyone to develop containers. So, so the base kernel is of Linux, and on top of that, you can have specialized images of Debian, Ubuntu, or of any other Linux-flavored operating system that you want. And these are very lightweight images, by the way. And then on top of that, you can install anything, okay? And you can set up your entire application. So what we'll do is we'll see an existing application, and we'll Dockerize that application right now, okay? So I'll just go back to my whatforlunch.py. Okay, our code is already stopped here. So I'll go to the code over here, and let me just switch to the what for lunch. I'm using PowerShell here, and PowerShell now uses almost a similar syntax as that of the shell in anywhere else. So cd flask. Okay. So before you actually go ahead and create your own Docker containers, you have to do two things, okay? I'll show you what those two things are. So we'll go to the code over here, and you will have to create a file called Dockerfile. Now this Dockerfile, I'm sure you can read it, but let me just increase the font a little bit, okay? And I'll just walk you through this file. This is the base image on which I'm working, okay? This image, you can find plenty of images on the Docker Hub, which is the registry where you keep everything, all the containers that you have developed on Docker. Okay, So I have taken this base image, which contains Python 2.7 inside Alpine. Alpine is a lightweight Linux container base image, okay? And it's really, really lightweight. I can show it to you that it's just a couple of MBs, not more than that. It contains the whole kernel of Linux within just a couple of MBs. Because it doesn't have any other applications, it just has the kernel, okay? Nothing more. So it has Python 2.7 pre-installed in it, so I don't need to install Python. But if you're using some other image, let's say very basic Ubuntu image or very basic Alpine image, you will have to install Python in it. Okay? This one comes pre-installed with Python. Now what I'm doing is I'm creating an app directory. And where am I creating this app directory? Within the container itself. So when I'll get the base image has nothing, right? So I'm just creating an app directory inside it. Then I'm changing it to the working directory. The working directory becomes user src app. After that, I copy my requirements.txt to the user src app. Okay? And after that, I run a pip install on requirements.txt just to make sure everything is installed. Okay? Then I copy everything from here, that is copy dot, to the user src app, and I expose 5000 port. Okay? And at the end, I do nothing but I run cmd python but for lunch.py. Okay? Now here, I'm going to make a small change. That change is that I'm going to enable the port. I'm going to change from localhost to 0000. And why am I doing so? Because if it is going to run on the localhost, I would not be able to make a tunnel. Because a container is like a virtual machine itself, right? So how do you reach to it? If it's running something, it's running inside it, okay? So you'll have to expose ports and you have to make sure that the IP that the container gets, you should be able to plug into that IP and browse your website, okay? So for that matter, we have done two things. We have actually exposed a port 5000 over there. And what I'll do here is that I'm going to change this to 0000, okay? And nothing more. I'm just going to disable the Python tools for Visual Studio. Okay, we're sort of good here. Now I'll go back to my code, and I'm going to check if I already have some images. So I'm going to do Docker images, and there are lots and lots of images here, but I'm going to pick this one. I'm just going to update this image. Okay, so I'll do Docker build. Thank you. Very generous. Thank you. Okay. So what I've done over here is that I'm saying that Docker build, and then I'm saying -t. That means this is the tag for the image that I'm going to create. And when I say this is the tag, /flask/lunch:latest, the /flask/lunch is the name of my container, and latest is the tag, okay? So if you have made some changes in your code, you can actually keep changing the tags if you want, okay? But I'm just keeping it latest because there is already a lot of clutter over here. And then I say dot. And you can see what it's doing. It's actually doing all the steps that we have written in the Docker file itself, okay? And right after this is done, we can go ahead and check the Docker image we have. Flask lunch was actually created 12 seconds ago. Now we can go ahead and run our application. So we'll say Docker run, okay, terminal -p. And through -p, I'm going to expose a local port, and I'm going to plug to the exposed port of the container. So I'm going to do 5000. / I'm just going to just paste it here. Okay. Port is already allocated. So now I have actually exposed 5000, but I'm connecting to the 5050 port of it because it probably is already on. So I'm just going to open it on 5050. Yeah, it opens well, and now we can work with it. This is a same application that you developed. Now it's running as a container. So I can make some change, test over here, I can say, hi, my name is Sahil, and I ate really hard pizza. Okay, it's working. Now, what we can do is, when I say control C, it doesn't mean that I've killed this application. So we can go ahead and see Docker run, Docker PS, and we can see all the running images over here. Okay. Now, if you want, this is a container itself running, which is running a version of Linux, right? So we can also get inside this container now. Okay. So let's just go ahead and get inside this container. So we'll say Docker exec-it interactive terminal. Okay. And I'm going to say /bin/bash. Oops. /docker-ps. Okay. Oops. Docker stop. I can stop this. We'll have to start it again. Yeah, it may take sometimes a lot of time to kill. Okay. And -d. No, actually, I actually stopped it by mistake. It was just not updating, actually. Oh my God, why is it not finding it? Okay, hang on. No, nothing actually. I actually need to use this ID. No. Come on. Anyways, I think the demo gods are not with me right now. Yeah. The demo gods are not helping. Anyways, so now what we will do is we will actually see if we can run the same container in the cloud. Okay? Now, remember we were talking about how to scale these containers in the cloud itself. Okay? So what I'll do is that I can now go to the cloud itself. I'm going to do a reload over here. I'm showing this to you on Azure, but it's available on other popular platforms as well, inclusive of Google and AWS. What we are doing over here is that I'm going to show you Microsoft's container service, also known as Azure Container Service, which runs Docker containers, Kubernetes containers, right? And it also supports DCOS and Swarm for orchestration. Now, I don't know if you guys know about DCOS or Swarm, but let me just simplify it for you. If you have a number of machines running in your data center, and if you want to treat them as just one single host, this is what you use, okay? DCOS or Swarm. So what it will do is it will understand that all of these machines are just one single host. So let's say that you have an application which requires 16 cores of CPU, okay? But a normal machine usually have just, let's say, 4 cores of CPU. Your machine has 4 cores. And if you have 10 machines, it will just understand that it has 16 cores of CPU to run on, okay? And that application will be ran on that collection of 4 machines, okay, at once. So this is the Azure Container Service, and in this container service, I'll show you, I have just one agent and I have just one master over here, okay? And to connect to that agent, I'll have to create a tunnel from here. So I'm creating a tunnel to 8080 port, okay, and through the port 2200, and this is the management ID of my Azure Container Service. And hopefully the tunnel will work. And it works. Connection timed out. If it times out one more time, we will abandon it here. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Well, looks like it's been blocked here. Okay, so let's just, I think I'm done with what I had to show. And if any one of you want to join me for the Docker birthday party, you are more than welcome. We are celebrating the fourth birthday of Docker today in Gurgaon office. So I'll be running for that. Tickets nahi lagenge, free of cost aur wahan cake hai. Okay, I'm open for questions now. Thank you. One question or are you done? Oh, please.
Okay, you can hear me. Right?
Yeah, I'll repeat your question. Yeah.
See, there's nothing to do with Docker. I think it's nice to see so how easy it is to Docker investigation. But my problem has always been with Python from Visual Studio.
Mm-hmm.
Even the latest release, 2017 release, when I went and looked at it, we said communication, there's no Python.
Yes.
So then I tweeted it, and somebody said, no, there is Python in Visual Studio, Python separately available in a future edition.
Okay. Yeah.
So why is like Python like so much behind when it is becoming such an important language?
Right. I remember when we were working in the beta releases of Visual Studio 2017, we released Visual Studio tools for Python for 2017. And in a lot of blogs, you will find information about that. The thing is that we ran into some issues right before the RC candidate happened. Okay, so the VS tools for Python works for VS 2015 right now, but they do not work for VS 2017 right now. Okay, it's not behind in our schedule. The thing is that you have to make sure that it's very sovereign and it works for you. Are you facing some real issues with VS 2015 tools for Python?
No, it's not. See, there are a lot of .NET development going on.
Right.
We're trying to switch a lot of the C# developers to Python.
Okay.
So we want to give them something before we go tell them to use it. We want to give them something that works.
I think you better switch to VS Code. Because that has a lot of good Python support, and these things all come within the VS Code itself. The Python debugging feature is already there within the VS Code, so you actually don't need VS full blown. But I can understand if you want to do unit testing and profiling. I think profiling is also covered in VS Code now, so you can depend on that at least, right? Okay. I think we are done. Thank you very much. You've been a great audience.